for the evening. The moderator for panel three is Dr. T.P. Sahu, medical oncologist from Bhopal. The panelists for the session are Dr. Sarvani Ghosh Laskar, radiation oncologist from Mumbai, Dr. Shevanti Limai, medical oncologist, Mumbai, Dr. Roshni Pandey, medical oncologist, Jabalpur, Dr. Vamshi Krishna, medical oncologist, Hyderabad, Dr. Vijay Patil, medical oncologist, Mumbai, and Dr. Prashant Mehta, medical oncologist, New Delhi. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. I'm audible, Kashish?
Yes, sir.
So it's raining heavily in Bhopal, and there's no a power cut, so let's see how long I can go in. So with all that, the last part of the practice changing, and it's on head and neck. So let's do something out of this. And I have a lovely panel and lovely panelists with me, and I hope they bring out good brownie points, which can really change or not change practice. So let's see what it is all about. So let's start off with the case. 47 years old male, chronic tobacco abuser. It's a cancer, left buccal mucosa extending to the lower GBS. Underwent composite resection. So we had a mandible and the lymph nodes resected. Margins was clear, mandible not involved. Two nodes were positive and they had extra nodal extension and with perineural invasion. So this is what it is. So I will come down to what next, and this is the options. If I go down to the options, and this is it is, and can I get in Shabani in first? And would you do radiotherapy? If yes, that's for sure. What dose would you plan for?
So good evening, everybody, and thanks for this invitation. I'd like by saying that, as I understood, you have a patient who's got, see, about the radiotherapy doses, I think I would give radiotherapy, but Dr. Sahu, can you just repeat about the cut margin status?
I'll tell you, the margins were clear. Mandibles were not in, the bone was not involved. Two nodes were positive of the dissected 21 nodes, and they had extra nodal extension, and there was perineural invasion.
Okay, so with this case, I think as per evidence, I would consider giving adjuvant CTRT.
Yeah.
And my dose for radiotherapy would be 64 gray in 32 fractions. Okay. I wouldn't go up to 66 gray because we have evidence to say that there is no point exceeding doses of 63 gray actually,
okay,
even with high risk features. And the radiotherapy.
Can I come in one point here for me or the medical oncologist, predominantly medical oncology panel? So if to little bit reading which I did for Astro and the other recommendation. If can you do boost up your bed to the positive margins if they have, or the external extension bed to 66 gray? Is the recommendation for that?
No. So if you go by the last paper from David Rosenthal, which is the paper that looked at stratifying and looking at the dose escalation. So there were three levels of doses that were offered to patients with intermediate and high risk features. And a dose of 57.6 is good enough for intermediate risk. But for the high-risk group, there is no advantage of going beyond 63 gray to 68.6 gray or anywhere there. Okay. Having said this, what I'd like to say is that most papers, whether you look at the RTOG or the ERTC papers looking at high-risk features, they've typically given 66 gray in 33 fractions, and that seems to be a favorite somehow.
Yeah.
But the evidence points to not giving more than 64 gray in 32 fractions.
So what do you have to say to two questions here? To 60 gray, which Tata paper alluded to, in which you are a part of it.
Yes.
That's what my first point will be. And what do you talk of the Japanese, the JCOG paper, which we'll be alluding to, which at 46 gray to the tumor bed and 20 gray was boosted up to the positive margins or to the extranodal site. What do you have to say to both the things?
Yeah, so what typically is done is what the Japanese group have done is they've used IMRT for all their patients,
mm-hmm,
and they've used what we call as a phased IMRT. So that is they've given the entire preoperative bed a dose of 46 gray. And after 46 gray, they have coned down to the high risk areas and given a 20 gray boost.
Yeah.
So typically in the Tata paper, we have, because of the sheer numbers, we could only use conventional radiotherapy. So our protocol is also somewhat similar. We give 46 gray to the entire region.
Okay.
And after 46, we kind of do a 4 gray with the off cord. That is, we spare the spinal cord. And then after the last 10 gray, we just give to the high risk volume. So we typically give a 60 gray, but if you have positive margins or areas of extranodal extension, we sometimes tend to boost, especially with positive margins, to 64 gray and 32 okay. fractions.
So last question to you before I move on. So do you feel that in the trial, none of your patients received more than 60 gray? That's what I take it.
Yeah.
So do you think that was inferior because 90% of your patients were high risk?
No, but then if you look at that, we've published, you know, because we have the OCAT trial also, which is 900 patients strong. Mm-hmm. And plus we have Vanita's paper. So I don't think, because the dose of radiotherapy was same across both arms.
Okay.
And I don't think because of the 60 gray and 30 fractions that resulted in the weekly doing inferior, we could discuss doses of cisplatinum afterwards.
Okay, sure. So now we come down to, I thought that was something for us as medical oncologists, we don't get this opportunity much to understand the doses. And I feel that intricacies are there and we have to understand that. So now coming down to the panel, to the medical oncologist, I go down to the first thing. Let's go to Vijay last because I know what his dose will be. That's out in the open. So Prashant, for you, it will be weekly or once in 3 weeks?
So the standard of care in my center is 40 mg per meter square weekly.
Okay, that's good. Shavanti, in your center?
So I use 40 milligrams per meter square. Earlier when I came back to India, I was using 35.
Okay.
And
So you use a weekly one and that's 35 to 40.
In certain patients, I've now started using 100 milligram per meter square. In the US, I always use 100 milligram per meter square. Okay. Now I'm trying to push 100 milligram per meter square in certain good performing patients. I even go to in a definitive setting, not in this particular setting.
So for Prashant, it's weekly always. For Shavanti, he chooses and picks and up within weekly and 3 weekly. Roshni, in Jabalpur, what would be a weekly?
40 milligram per meter square.
Yeah,
initially, I was using 30 milligram per meter square because of more referrals from TMH, but now it is 40 milligram per meter square.
Because they wrote it down in the prescription and patients won't change it. That's how it is.
No, now we need to go up to the standard of care. We can't just compromise on the dose.
Okay, so let's now find out. And Vamsi, for you, in your center, Hyderabad.
I am actually a little different. I used to do 100 per milligram per 3 weekly for the last 3-4 years. Uh-huh. But now actually for a few patients where the tolerance may not be so good, and stuff like that, I'm actually okay with 40 milligram also because I think the data is now coming a bit equivalent. So I'm now okay with both. But
so now,
is my
preference. So now, Vijay, the whole panel loaded wants to go to 40. So they are tilting towards Japanese trial. So now would you tell that is 30 per meter square what you mentioned in the TMH publication for Vanita is good enough or once in 3 weeks is what was justified in the paper? Vijay.
Yeah, we at Tata, if the patient is fit for cisplatin, we are using 100 milligram per meter square.
Apart from that, if not, which is the weekly dose you use?
If the patient is not fit or has borderline performance status, then we would go to 40.
Okay, 40 per meter square.
But if fit, 100.
So why did your paper have 30 per meter square in the trial?
So the 30 per meter square dose of cisplatin was been used since few decades in Tata.
Okay.
And we had two studies from Tata. Both were led by Dr. Salvani. One was in radical setting of RT compared with RT plus cisplatin 30. One was the OCAD trial also, which was ongoing. RT versus RT plus 30 milligram per meter square was the and both the studies have shown that addition of 30 milligram per meter square to radiotherapy versus radiotherapy had actually led to benefit. And so that dose was used and hence it was selected.
So Vijay, what I get out of you is that 100 per meter square is the standard. If not, then you have also shifted beyond 30 and have pumped up your dose to around 40 per meter square.
We use 30 only in patients who have received neoadjuvant chemotherapy with cisplatin.
Okay.
Or else if the patient is per primum, 100 to fit. If borderline suspicious we are, then 40.
You have a variable doses. So let's come down to and let's get a few expert opinions on this. All of you have seen this. Exactly both this trial, which I'll be comparing with the Tata trial, have really the same patient subtype except for Tata had the radical CTRT and the adjuvant in combined, while the Japanese had only the post-operative. And if you look at further, that basic difference, what I wanted to point out is the oral cavity was a 40% in the Japanese, while in the Indian paper, it was a 90%. Other than that, the risk factors was 100% in the Japanese, while the Indian paper had 92% of high risk factors. The T and the N stage were nearly matching each other. So now, Vijay, coming to two, you have been a part of this study and now the Japanese is out. What do you think worked for Japanese and what did not work for you?
First thing, maybe Dr. Sahu, it may be that yes, 40 might be good enough. That would should be the, that is maybe the first reason why the Japanese paper worked and 30 might really be inferior than 100. So that is the first thing. But the thing is that I would like to read the full text of this paper because I have reservations regarding this.
The sample, what is the reservation?
My reservation is regarding if you look at the distribution of risk factors in this study, mm-hmm. in the Japanese study, somehow all high risk factors like higher amount of hypopharynx, a higher amount of T4 stage, higher amount of nodal positivity actually gets distributed towards the 3 weekly. The second is this this protocol of the study not doing complete was published in 2014. And that said that there were 3 interim analyses to be done for the study. One after completion of phase 2, one after half sample size was recruited for phase 3, and
I'd
one
like
after
to stop
the full...
Vijay, I'll talk to stop yeah. you for a minute here, but I look at the risk factors very, very carefully, and I looked at, except for that, they took 100% of the high risk factors. Yeah. The end stage, N2 were majority 70%, then Japanese also was 70%, except for few more T3. It was well matched.
So if you look at the T4, there's 58 and 69.
That's fine.
So when you see it's a 260 patient study, there are 130 patients. For a 10% difference, if you create in T4 disease, you would get that amount of difference in the survivals also. And in fact, this was not my comment. This was actually pointed out by the ASCO discussion also by Hashim. Where he said it, suggested that both the for the T and the for the hypopharynx, the results needs to get need to get adjusted. The reason why I was harping upon the interim analysis is because this was a non-inferiority study.
Yeah.
To conclude non-inferiority on an interim analysis, understand this is not the final analysis. For the interim analysis is very difficult. Second, if you see the sample size calculation was done for 5-year OS. The non-inferiority has been claimed on 3-year OS, not for the 5-year OS. If you look at the risk factors at the 5-year OS, they actually come down to some number at risk is 12 or 14 in both arms. So the actual data is not mature enough.
I agree. But on the maturity data which we have, Seventy, coming to you, do you think it is time for us to think that in this high-risk subset of patients who have a high-risk patient, either for the nodal, extranodal extensions or the positive margins, it is good enough to give a weekly cisplatin rather than a 3-weekly?
So, TP, my main point, I've just put it in the chat box as well, is to push the dosing. We have enough data now to understand that we have to chase the numbers. And whether you give weekly or you give every 3-weekly, it's about how much cumulative cisplatin we gave. Unfortunately, that is the hard truth. That's where our bottom line draws. When we contribute to radiation, and if we wish to contribute appropriately, especially to the high-risk group, we really need to push the dose. So 40 milligram for now, weekly, it stays. And if you are doing every 3-weekly, even then, we have to look at which patients we can offer.
What percentage of our patients do complete this three cycles of cisplatin out of every 100?
So one-third.
One-third complete, two-third do not. So yeah. Ultimately, you land up in giving a sub-inferior dose of the cisplatin.
That's correct. And that is where I think weekly comes in, because it's not 200 milligrams.
Yeah.
It is somewhere between 200 and 300. If you push 40 milligram per week and you're able to give all the dosages.
At least even 6 doses if you give, you're touching 240.
Exactly. So that is better than just giving 2 large 3-weekly doses.
Prashant, can I come
Dr.
in?
Sahu. And, yeah, Prashant. Sahu, can I get in here? Okay.
Yeah. Vansi, you take in then. If you have got in, just look
nothing.
At this.
I just want. Correct. Yeah, I just wanted to point
graph.
Out.
Just look at this graph. I'll take your point.
I just wanted to point out in the Japanese study, they had a requirement that patients should have finished at least 2 doses out of 3 in the 3-weekly and 5 out of 7 of the radiation weekly.
Yes.
And remember, the patients who are on the weekly usually end up with 5 or 6. They also don't go up to the 7 doses most commonly. I agree with Dr. Senanthi, only 1/3 to maybe 40% will get 300 3-weekly. I don't think all the 40 milligram will get all
in
7.
In the Tata data, actually, in the trial setting, 66% of their patients actually completed the 3 cycles.
only
the trial setting. We are talking
on a trial setting. I'm talking of, let's talk of trial setting, because talking of trial setting, that will be fair to them.
Sure.
I want to come to Prashant. Prashant, look at these graphs and look at the local relapse-free survival. And if I look at it, it's actually the opposite what I'm seeing here. Once in 3 weeks appears better to for us in the Indian data, and once in weekly appears better for the Japanese. And 3 years time is good enough for a local regional thing. Do you think that this will now stay on?
Yeah, so to me, it is always, I have always been convinced that weekly is better. So okay. To my mind, when the TMH paper came in, I was not influenced and I did not change any of my practices.
Shabani, yeah.
Also, there is another important contention which is probably not being discussed, that in the weekly regimen, you are getting an opportunity to correct all the problems, all the issues of the patient in daycare every week. And opportunities missed. Okay. And the patients are not monitored properly also. I think the weekly regimen is better to monitor the patient monitor the progress of the patient.
But I think that the radiation oncologist does review the patient once a week. Shabani, if I can bring you here.
Not how the medical oncologist reviews the patient.
Dr. Sahu, I review my patients once a week or 3 weekly. I call them once after 1 week and I call them at 2 weeks also.
Yeah, so the OPD, the outpatient visit is not enough. So the daycare admission is what you're able to give fluids, you're able to handle.
Dr. Shabani, yes. It's a question, doctor. Do you agree to this comment that...
I don't agree at all. I actually don't agree because I think we are the ones who look after the weekly
okay.
Much
keeping that apart.
We've been used to it, you know, because we've been used to doing this. Actually, this is quite a
agree. Both protocol. I think both the oncologist sector do look at the patient.
Prashant,
cool down. I wanted a more serious question to answer from you, Dr. Shabani.
Yeah, yeah.
Now looking at these curves, after 3 years, do you feel these curves do tell a message that if the local regional relapse has not happened in 3 years, will that change now?
I don't think so. Actually,
that's the point I wanted to move up.
Yeah, because after 1.5 years in head and neck cancers, you don't expect to see too many events happening. And most of the events that would be happening would be because of toxicity rather than because of disease.
So my point of this was bringing out was very, very pertinent to what Vijay told. That's why I was harping on this interim analysis, because 3 years time, the local regional curves looks to me very advantageous for the weekly. Okay.
Dr. Sahu, I'd like to cut you here. Can you tell me what was the RTOG
911
5-year and 10-year survival?
Vijay, I'll come down.
RTOG 911 has published the 10-year survival. What was the survival of 3 years, 5 years and 10 years?
Vijay, the problem is when it's my baby, it's always more very, very...
No, the question is, there won't be events. Let me tell you, RTOG larynx...
I was coming to a more serious point.
57% in the CTRT ham.
But what we need to understand is that the RTOG, the late results are essentially events, and they've censored after 5 years, essentially because the non-cancer related deaths became much higher. And that's what we learned
I agree, madam, that non-cancer related deaths
and Dr.
were
Shabani,
higher, but there were only 30%.
Pause, 70% of deaths were because of cancer.
Vijay,
we need to pause. There is a panel. We need to discuss other issues. I totally take your point that yes, 3 weekly has a point to make, but these trials do make a point for weekly. Okay. Now coming to the dose which all of us wanted to know, and Roshni can tell here, because I put the Tata thing in the things which are written here. 56 patients did complete 2 cycles. So it is actually what Shavanti was talking to. It is actually in the trial setting thing. So my point was, is the Tata results inferior because they could deliver lesser dose? Can you, Dr. Roshni, what do you feel so?
The dose intensity was less. But if we look at the 100 milligram per meter squared every 3 weekly, we are never able to give the third dose.
Okay. No. They did give the third. Vijay, can you have a small comment on this and I move on?
Yeah.
On the dose intensity.
So the planned dose intensity was maintained, Dr. Sahu. I get your point. The cumulative dose in weekly arm was less than the cumulative dose in the 3 weekly arm.
Yes.
The dose intensity, if you ask me, was maintained. It was maintained because dose intensity is calculated in accordance with what was planned and what was delivered.
I know. It was 100% for your paper.
What was planned was delivered.
But yeah. overall, it was less in comparison to the 3-weekly.
No, no, no. We are just looking into intricacies of how to plan it further so that each of our patients benefit. So that's the point.
As compared to the Japanese study, 40 milligram per meter squared, the dose intensity and cumulative dose both are more.
Okay, Vijay, a final question to you before we move on. Let's say the final analysis comes and this results hold true. Would it be enough to say that weekly will be the gold standard?
The trial is a non-inferiority trial. If the final analysis also holds on, so I would say that we have both options of 3-weekly and weekly.
Okay, fair enough.
If it actually comes out and shows that it is superior, then yes, we need to change our practice to 40 and not to give 100.
Okay, fair
Dr.
enough.
Dr. Sahu,
yeah, please.
Ask a question to the medical oncologists here.
Yeah.
So now if you look at both trials, what we see very clearly is that there is a different difference in the cumulative difference doses of cisplatinum across both arms.
Yes.
What the traditional teaching is to try and reach a dose of 200 milligram per meter square. But if you see in both trials, the doses, the median doses are around 300 milligram per meter square in the Tata trial and 210. And the other one is 280 and 239. The 239 doing better, which is the weekly. So what is the explanation for this?
Anyone want to take it? Vijay, you want to take it? Or Vamsi, you want to take it?
So, ma'am, that is the median dose.
Yeah.
So, the MRC goes with 200 versus 300. And I think anything above 200 is what is the benefit is showing. So, I'm not actually understand. You're saying that 300 was there. That's why they have done better? Or what exactly is the point?
No, so, I want to know your explanation. Because, see, in the Japanese trial, though the 3-weekly did achieve a higher cumulative dose, about 280.
Yeah.
The weekly was 239. Should I tell now?
Actually, yes. There's a hypothesis that beyond 200, there's a flattening effect of the drugs. That is not tested on a definitely phase 3 trial, but that hypothesis still persists, that after a particular point of cisplatin, the more you give, it does not work more, and there's actually a plateauing effect. I think we will stop.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to hear actually. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
science is science. And it has to be respected. So if I difference, the difference is the technically the same number of patients, oral cancers could probably be that point, because there's a significant difference in the Indian and the Japanese data. Dose would have been a major difference, but no, the radiation oncologist dose, the radiation oncologist panel, Dr. Shavani told they both had the same radiotherapy. Chemotherapy was the mood difference. Toxicity, the Japanese had a different toxicity. I didn't go to toxicity, but they had a very different toxicity from what we normally see. So will it change practice? No need. We already followed that. The panel told all of them did weekly. Few of them told they wanted to do once in 3 weeks and they will not do it. Survival, because of higher weekly dose, that's what it is. RT dosing schedule, we have spoken. So now let's go on. The patient was on follow-up. After 10 months, had opposite lower neck node, opposite side, which was positive on cytology. What next? Can I come to 70? What would you do in your hospital?
So if it's a single site recurrence, I may think of...
How do you know?
Even if it is an opposite node, I may think of just resecting that.
Would you do a PET scan in such cases?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So if a PET scan is normal, only one activity site, then you think of a resection. That's what you meant.
Yes.
Okay. So we did a PET scan. It was suggestive of lung metastasis. So now, Prashant, what would you need further from me?
Yeah.
So, anything more?
No, nothing more. Just I'll do the biopsy and I'll do the PDL1 on that. Yeah.
Cytology done. It is positive for squamous cell carcinoma. Biopsy is squamous cell. Yeah.
Then so I'll do the PDL1 IHC on that. 22C3 clone.
So we did a CPS and it was 2%.
Okay. So I would.
It's a well preserved 48 years old male, sole earner, Supreme Court lawyer by professional. So Supreme Court lawyer brings in Dr. Parikh. You have to be legally very correct. So now what to do?
So choose. I would
please take your choose.
Yeah, I prefer the chemo immunotherapy only.
Okay, chemo immunotherapy.
The situation which you have given me.
Okay, 72% the data from the 048 tells that single agent pembro is also approved. Why not?
Yeah, so it is approved, but you know, the patient has so you could even give, you know, and I would err on the side of that because it's on the lower end. So if I had a 10% CPA score or higher, I would be more comfortable using Pembro alone.
Okay.
If it is right on borderline, I would give
Pembro. So 70, keep that 10% in your mind, I'll come down to that. Vamsi, what is your choice?
Yeah. I would go with the chemoimmunotherapy. I do not agree with the analysis was for more than 20% and 1 to 20%. And 20% and above, definitely pembrolizumab single agent is an option. 1 to 20, the benefit is hardly 1.2 or 1.3 months, something like that. So I do not agree
Roshni,
with that.
Roshni, what is your choice?
Since the CPS score is low, I would go with chemoimmunotherapy
it is,
and also
it is 2%,
looking.
It is 2%.
Yeah, and also looking at the data on PFS too. I would keep it in mind and discuss with the patient.
Okay, let's go to Vijay. Now the final take, Vijay.
Yeah, so I would discuss with the patient the option of Pembro plus chemotherapy, even the extreme regimen and the metronomic regimen, and let the patient choose. Explaining the risk, benefits,
what,
side
what
effects.
What would you choose?
Visit.
What would you choose? Everything.
No,
is
I don't choose
Dr.
Sahu. I let the patient choose.
No, that's true.
I give the options.
No, that's true. But now in the panel, you take your pick.
So the first option I'll give you him is pembrolizumab plus chemotherapy. Yes.
Okay. So do you tell that in the affordable class extreme regimen is out, Vijay?
No, I will give that as the next option to the patient.
No.
I actually make a table, Dr. Sahu, in which I give write the name
of
the
all
regimens,
of us do that. No,
life
you're not
expectancy,
getting my point.
Side effects, quality of life issues, cost, and hospitalization, all issues on one table and let them choose after
agree.
That.
I'm coming to a different point, Vijay.
Yeah.
Pembrolizumab is the first choice. So should I tell in the affordable class with a good performance status, good deep pocket, extreme regimen is out now.
Overall survival is better with
overall survival is better for me. Yes, I would err on the side of pembrolizumab plus chemotherapy.
70, you shook your head. Is extreme out, or you do have some patients which you want to do it?
No, so I would consider. I mean, it's not. See, when we talk about 2%, again, it comes down to the biomarker.
Yeah.
If this were really borderline and someone is not picking it right, then below 1%, you don't see the benefit.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where extreme comes in.
Okay.
And I would leave it there or you know, TP extreme comes in, where I mean Cetux comes in, and Pembro benefit with chemo was not that profound. So, you know, it's a longitudinal path. It isn't a cut and dry. And unless we have very high numbers, we have to take this with a pinch of salt.
So now, Prashant, single agent Pembro, CPS, let's say 25. When would you not consider?
When I would not consider when the CP is 25.
Yeah.
When
single
patient,
agent.
Yeah. When the patient is not able to afford it.
That's for sure he can afford it. That's why the question
yeah.
is there. Any
yeah.
other any other subset?
Any other subset. When the CPS is more than 25%, I would push for Pembro alone. Yeah.
Okay.
I would push for it.
Vijay, any subset which you as a clinician would not push?
A single agent Pembro?
Yeah,
if the CPS is 25 and the patient is quite symptomatic, then
yeah.
I may actually push for Pembro plus chemotherapy. And the reason is the higher amount of response rates.
Okay, it makes sense. And one more point which I wanted to make out, if you pull out the data from the Pembro chemo versus Cetux chemo, if the patient has a recurrence only in the local regional site without evidence of metastasis, this is the subset which really the therapy of immunotherapy does not do much benefit, then the extreme of the data is most beneficial. Bulky disease is what people have pointed out, and this is very important for all of us to remember, that the most significant amount of progressions happened in single agent Pembro. And that is to the tune of 40%. 70 wanted to make a point.
So that is correct, and that is why I err on the side of giving combination more. Than single agent. However, you know, when the numbers are very high, you take that risk, but you have to always look at the disease burden.
No, but I think this is just justifiable. This because if there's a bulky disease, you are impinging on a big bulky node with metastasis, strider is a borderline, you would like to err on the side of chemotherapy with Pembro. The data is very clear because the progression is 41%. That's huge progression rates. And if you look at the PFS, it has been very, very depressing on the chemotherapy, immunotherapy arm. What do you make of this curves? Any one of you, Bamsi, can you come on to the circled one? The best benefit of the response starts only happening after 8 months or 6 months. And if I look at the median survival of the Tata data of 8 months, 50% of patients would have died by that time. So what do you make of this?
No, see, the Tata data, we cannot really extrapolate to this. I think is not
explained. Look across the data trial, the median OS of the head and neck cancer, except for extreme, has been 7 to 8 months. Just have a look on this curves. Do you have to say anything?
I am actually not really. You're trying to say that the benefit of IO comes after 8 months. I think that's what we see with IO. Is that what you're trying to say? I'm not getting the point. I think Dr. Seventy, can you take this? I'm not really understanding the...
Very provocative here. I think if this were to run here, you would even have worse numbers. And I feel that way because we have much more aggressive disease. I see much more aggressive disease in India. So my thought is Pembro alone should really be given with a lot of thought here. Because we are dealing with...
This also happens with Pembro plus chemo. The same curves do not separate before 6-8 months. So is a consistent thing of lung cancer. In the lung, it is around 4 months. In the head and neck, it's 6 to 8 months.
Yes, so head and neck disease is much more immunoquiet. And so the benefit that you start getting right from the start in lung patients, you don't see that. You're dealing with squamous that responds very slowly in an immune desert. And that's why you are seeing this. I think if we were to bring this data to the Indian scenario, you would have even worse results.
Okay, so I was coming to the CPS 1 to 20. So 70 told 10. So I told her to stop there and look at this data. And we look at this data of OS and look at between 1 to 20, actually Pembro plus chemotherapy is the only regimen that's probably showing benefit. If you look at the single agent pembrolizumab, it is actually no better than extreme. And that is the point which I wanted to make, that the drip that's happening is basically because of the higher CPS. And if you look at the 1 to 20 data, it's actually not better than extreme. Any comments, Vijay first.
Dr. Sahu, but what you also need to see here is that even if Pembro mono versus extreme doesn't show benefit, the amount of grade 3 and 4 side effects in the extreme regimen in this trial was around 85%. And those seen in Pembro monotherapy were around 55%. There were around 10% deaths in the extreme trial. So with even
so
if
you
no
not go for it,
OS, but there is definitely.
But would you not go for a chemotherapy and Pembro for below 20? That's my point.
Yeah, obviously that would be my choice also.
Yeah, so that the approval although is beyond 1%, all of us think. Roshni, what is your thought?
For CPS more than 20, we give a combination therapy, and we give a combination therapy for CPS less than 20. If it's more than 20, you can give Pembro alone depending on the symptoms and the rapidity of response one desires and side effects and comorbidity.
And Prashant, just look also here at the response rate. 1 to 19, if you look at 20, the response is around 10 to 15% also. So in this subgroup, I am very doubtful of the benefit of single agent Pembro. Prashant, your take.
Yeah. So 1 to 20%, I definitely said chemo immunotherapy. So more than 20% was is the more debatable, part. More than 20% single agent Pembro, I'm inclined to use.
Okay. Can you take one more question for me? Let's hope this patient, you use immunotherapy second line. Do you do a PDL? And if you do a PDL1, what is the cutoff for you to use immuno?
I didn't get your question actually.
Let's say the patient received extreme as the first line therapy.
Okay.
Then has come to you on progression. You wanted to use immunotherapy or even checkpoint.
Fine.
So do you do a PDL1 and what is the cutoff to use PDL?
Yes, I do PDL1 and I use a CPS more than equal to 1. That is my cutoff. Less than 1, I would not use immunotherapy.
Okay, so the same thing comes here. Now I want you to comment again on this graph. Again, this is it not mad that CPS more than 50 drives the survival? If you look at the graphs coming on from the data, and if you look at from 040, this is from 040, and it looks that below 50, the graphs do not separate. So would we be not doing justice to our patients to only offer it to above 50 PD-L1.
Yeah, that's also a point taken, because in head and neck and post the extreme regimen and like refractory situation, immunotherapy is not that good, not as good as lung cancer. So like head and neck cancer, I'm not that impressed anyways with immunotherapy. So more than 50%, even better.
70, yeah. Your take, less, more than one or more than 50?
So yes, it is being driven by more than, so that is why, you know, I actually don't keep a cutoff of even 20. I have to really see very high scores, and that's when I would offer a single agent. Otherwise, my patient gets combination.
In the second line,
the patient has failed progressed after extreme.
You have to see what the patient received in the first line.
Has received extreme regimen first line.
Okay.
Failed after 8 months. Has come to you, and you did a TPS, and the TPS score of what will drive you to do the immunotherapy?
No, so second line, I'm game with immunotherapy. As long as the patient does not have a large disease burden and it allows me to introduce immunotherapy and has time.
Dr. Sahu,
yeah.
Why are you talking about the TPS in terms of Pembro? Nevo doesn't need anything, and Nevo has shown some response.
Actually, if you go to the subset analysis and go to details of it, I pulled out. I did not put it because of lack of time. That also shows the same thing. PDL more than 50% drives that benefit. But, so let's move on. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
fine. Let's move on.
Yeah. One point that I wanted to make is, you know, there are, so I've had patients who have been, you know, PDL1 low, PDL1 negative, who've had responses. When you get into head and neck, you don't have too many choices. And that's where you have to decide whether you want to give this ultimate exposure to the patient, one chance at life.
That's okay, who all are doing other biomarkers, testing for, let's say, TMB in such a situation? That's what I would like to ask.
Very high in head and neck.
Okay, we move on. We have 10 more minutes. So when do we choose single agent? We have told that when not to choose single agent Pembro, bulky disease, loco regional only relapse, don't use it. Extreme regimen, if it is not affordable for immunotherapy or not candidate for that, you'll give HD. So now, Vijay, you come in. Who for metronomic?
Who can't afford immunotherapy and extreme?
Okay, that's your conclusion. That's what I read it. So,
Dr. Sahu, PS2 and PS3. PS2, PS3.
PS2, PS3. Vijay, can you take that? Do you feel and agree to the statement?
PS3, I won't give any chemotherapy unless the PS is actually because of the disease kind of thing. PS2, I would still give metronomic and try.
Okay, Roshni, how many patients of yours in your practice out of 10 do you give metronomic, and what are the causes?
Almost 8 out of 10, because we have very early relapses, even 3 months and within 6 months. Second is the socioeconomic, and third is the performance status.
Okay, I'll come down to the early relapse, and I want Vijay to answer that, not now, later on. Not Vijay, others. 70, have you used the single agent cisplatin ever in head and neck outside the trial setting?
So I have used single agent drugs, including single agent cisplatin.
Outside a trial setting.
And I'll just take this moment to say that the metronomic combination, the three drug combination, actually needs to be studied head to head with the options that we've just discussed. It's a very potent regimen.
To be fair to the TMH guys, they wrote it that for those who cannot afford this extreme and the immunotherapy, this is the option. So I wanted to come to Prashant. Have you ever tried single agent cisplatin outside a trial setting?
No.
Vamsi is no, because
tried.
Yeah, you have tried.
But Dr. Sahu, I think what Dr. Seventy is saying is very important. I think Vijay also agrees on this. And the three drug is actually better than the two drug. The three drug, when you add an erlotinib, has really good response rates. And I personally don't use a two drug at all. I only go for three drug, and we have seen good response. And I actually think it is as good as a combination chemotherapy. Maybe not an immuno, but at least a combination is as good as that.
So this is what the Lancet publication put up. I will just come down to one thing, which Vijay, I think I will need an answer from you. Before that, I'll want to go to, does responses matter? Vijay, can you take this? Because the responses for the metronomic is 13%. For a couplet of taxanes and platinum, it is around 25 to 30%. For a patient who is very symptomatic for head and neck cancers, do you think responses matter?
Dr. Sao, yes, I think responses matter. Okay. We have always seen with doublet metronomic chemotherapy that the response rate always has been between around 10 to 20%. So what you're suggesting is correct. If the patient is largely symptomatic, I would need a faster response. Okay. I would go for a doublet chemotherapy, or I would go for what Vamshi and Dr. Shevanti are stressing on, or for a triple drug metronomic, which actually gives a response rate of 45%.
Yes. Okay. Yes. So that is where the EGFR, if you put together, the responses are much higher. So it comes down to that metronomic. Also, you have to choose and pick patient. You do not do it for everyone. I have one question for, let's say, 70 first. The Tata data, 30% of the population had platinum refractory disease. How do you justify single agent cisplatin in this subset of patients?
This was a study. In normal course, we don't offer.
No. In the study, we are now looking at study in detail.
So,
I have Dr. a comparator arm of cisplatin, and 30% were patients who relapsed within 6 months.
Correct. So I'll tell you, this is something where you're not looking at immunotherapy. Otherwise, if you look at a combination, you are offering platinum in combination every place. If you look at TP extreme, if you look at extreme,
My question was different. Vijay, can you take that? I hope you have understood the point.
Yeah, I got your point, Dr. Sahu. Yeah. The reason is platinum refractory disease, we put it as
3 months. You took it as 3 months.
6 months, mixed months, but there are variable definitions of platinum refractory disease also. In fact, Dr. Vermakon has wrote a paper on it, and with an elaborate discussion how it can be defined with respect to the time point, with respect to the cumulative dose.
But to make all the things short,
let me complete, Dr. Sahu.
Yeah, please.
Before this also, we had done a phase 2 study, and what we had actually done was, at that time of point, we saw that we had taken patients who had failed after 3 months. Okay, so we had not used the definition of platinum refractory of within 6 months. We had used the definition of within 3 months. And between 3 to 6 months also, we saw that there were responses to cisplatin. And that's the reason why we went ahead with this protocol with the same criteria.
I read the whole thing.
When you look at the, as we were pointing out in the earlier part of Japanese study, most of the failures actually, which continued till 1.5 to 2 years, actually happened within the first six to nine months.
Okay.
Rapidly comes down.
The point which I was making is that most of the trials across, which have been the major trials, have taken 6 months as the cutoff.
Yeah.
So my
all
point
those
of
trials, Dr. Sahu, have also not taken PS2 patients. If you go back and check, Keynote 04 has not taken PS2 patients.
Let me make
Arini, we have 2 minutes left.
I'm finishing it. Let me make the point. The point here is, when we have a single agent platinum and we have taken 1/3 of the patients as platinum refractory, I think that point has to be highlighted when we talk of this trial. And that is what I wanted this panel to justify. That's all, nothing else. So is it reasonable to conclude that unaffordable oral cancer patient with platinum refractory setting, metronomic would be a decent option? Quick answer. Roshni, yes, no?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay. So 70, yes, no?
Yes, I'm a big fan.
Okay.
Thoroughly.
Okay. So in the affordable patient, what will be the ideal sequencing? All of us spoke of that. For the lack of time, I'll just go to the last slide. This is a trial of the -5FU extreme, the TPEX trial. And if you look at it, this showed the survival and the IOs do much better if it is followed a non-5FU regimen. Any quick comments on it? One of you. 70.
Dr. Sahu, this is a post.
All moved
this
over
is post.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Ma'am ji, please.
So this is a post subset analysis. This is like a force. You read the paper, it's just like they're trying to force a sequence. Okay. Like you have to give cetuximab first and IO first, second. I don't think we should really give much credence to it.
Very good. 70, so I'm coming to the point of it. That's okay. We'll stop here. Extreme regimen, to be honest, is the multi-drug protocol, has its own difficulty. With TPX sequencing, how about cisplatin with doxyplatinum following in the second line? Vamshi pointed out that still a lot of things has to be done. So to conclude, for the high risk post-surgery, radiotherapy at 60 to 66 gray. That's what was told in the start. Shavani told us. Cisplatin 40 milligram per meter square is what all of us agreed to, but 100 milligram per meter square still remains. Single agent pembrolizumab, be careful with the bulky disease. Here, pembro plus chemotherapy would be better. Loco regional only recurrences, extreme data is better. CPS score, does it matter? Yes, it does matter. Higher CPS score will be more comfortable. PD-L1 in second line beyond 50, I think the evidence is much stronger. Metronomic, cheap, doable. Now we have evidence thanks to the TMH paper. Probably best suited for unaffordable oral cancers because there are 90% of patients with oral cancers and there the other chemotherapies are not that active and active only also in early relapses. That's the highlight of the paper which I felt. Platinum sensitivity is an important factor. In practice, taxane-platinum combo still popular. All of us still do it every day. I think, Prashant, that could be our take home, all of us in private practice. And sequencing data attractive, but still the last word has not been told. So the last slide, we have two Indias, one which goes to 70 and the other which comes to me. So for I just wanted to ask one thing,
why is the take home different for those in private practice? Why did you say that?
No. I told the Pakli and the taxane carboplatin is still very popular.
The standard of care is the same for those in government or private.
I told you. Totally. Yeah, no, I didn't mean it that way. I'm sorry if that has gone that way.
Yeah, it hurt me.
So now for the affordable, the TPX protocol at relapse, followed by ICI and metronomic, or the immunotherapy and chemotherapy first line is what for the affordable. But I think metronomic, followed by best supportive care, has made its ground. So I think that we end the panel. And I did not mean that, Prashant. I meant that Pakli and carboplatin is still a popular choice and still that is a most popular regimen still used across the country.
Yeah, that's I get the point, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, everyone. In our request, Dr. Anand, we are medical oncologists from New Delhi to please give his expertise and also to moderate the question answer session.
Kashish, do we have question answers?
So we have one.
Yes, I thought so because majority were comments rather than questions. Can I have that one question? Yeah, that was, I think Dr. Amit from Pune had written that there was option in Dr. Sahu sir's slide 50 mg per week. I think what he understood was 50 mg fixed dose.
Yeah.
50 mg fixed dose, probably in a surface area of 1.5 and above, may not come to 200 mg per meter square of the cumulative dose.
No, it is so, the 50 milligrams per week fixed dose is what fixed dose. Few centers practice. That's what
I'm saying. So this is, and I think I'll start my comment with this. Dr. Bharat had put in on the chat that we talk so much about dose, but finally we do what we do in practice. But what I wanted to tell Bharat and my expert comment was, Roshni, as she rightly said, 30 milligram per meter square is out. I think that is what the practice change has happened. And what I understood from Dr. Sarbani and from Tarini's panel is that we used to believe that patients who can take 100 milligram per meter square three times is probably the best. But I don't think that is the message which is coming out. The message is coming out is that the 40 milligram per meter square weekly versus 100 milligram per meter square three weekly, both are almost equal. They are giving equal results. And that is what I think one of the two should be practiced. Coming to the relapse setting, I think one of the point which I wanted to highlight as what Tarini said, in practice, Pakli Carbo, we practice a lot. In practice, we do not practice single agent cisplatin. I don't think that is the norm even in, like I practice in Delhi, entire Delhi, I don't see that this is single agent cisplatin is being practiced anywhere. So I'm sure it must be getting practiced in some centers, but not to the best of my knowledge. One of the points which people are forgetting, kept on talking immunotherapy plus chemo. Please remember the entire data of immuno plus chemo is with cisplatin and 5-FU. And the same cisplatin and 5-FU, as Vijay Patil says, gives grade 3, grade 4 toxicity in more than 80% of patients. So Vamshi, what you said is correct. The read of the data was too much. But imagine a scenario where TP extreme or TPX followed by immunotherapy or immunotherapy followed by TPX. I think that is the sequence probably which will be practice changing in our clinical day-to-day life. I truly believe that TPX is very much tolerated by patient, and the results take first line and second line put together are not inferior compared to immunotherapy plus chemotherapy. In terms of immunotherapy alone versus immunotherapy plus chemotherapy, there was a lot of discussion, and I tend to agree with Vijay Patil. This is the time we need to talk to patients. Like, I have had patients who do not want to take chemotherapy. So KEYNOTE-048 told us that chemotherapy plus immunotherapy versus immunotherapy, immunotherapy overall survival is not inferior. One of the other points which I wanted to highlight, which is not touched upon, is hyperprogression on immunotherapy. I think this is a big thing. Sahu showed the curve. In that curve, the first 6 months, the hyperprogressors, they may end up dying very fast compared to when they are exposed to chemotherapy or chemotherapy with cetuximab. This is a point which we need to understand. We still do not have a mechanism by which we can identify who are going to be hyperprogressors. So that is something which we need to keep in mind. In terms of early relapse, I think platinum refractory, metronomic, even in those who are affording, we need to do a trial, metronomic versus immunotherapy in early relapsers, and we need to see. I think metronomic, and as Dr. Vamshi and Dr. Vijay Patil said, triplet metronomic probably may turn out to be a good standard of care, even in affording patients in early relapses. And of course, response rates matter, and that's where I agree with Tarini, that doublet chemotherapy is definitely gives more response rate, more satisfying to patient as compared to single agent cisplatin. With that, I conclude my comments and over to Kashish.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you everyone for participating in this webinar.
Can we ask Sevanthi's comments, please?
Yes, that's what I was saying. We can conclude with Dr. Sevanthi's comments.
So I think today's three panels were phenomenal. I haven't been so energized and excited in a long time, and it was very feisty. I have really been looking forward to such discussions. I'm always shy of such discussions and scared because I've never done this kind of head-on discussions, but it was a pleasure. And the best part was the moderators were phenomenal. They were, total pros. And like I said, these were blockbusters coming up. So totally honored to participate. And the panelists were so feisty, including myself. There was a different side that came out. So this is, I would say the Amish is doing to make us rise up to this debate and bring in moderators that would really make us war together and duel it out. And so such a pleasure to participate through and through and put our version. I hope that the entire attendees team is going home with some clarity to the data and also how we practice lung cancer therapy and head and neck cancer therapy in India. Western data is there, but how do we implement it here and what is more feasible and what not? So a pleasure and an honor to co-host this with Amish, and thank you for inviting me, and such a pleasure to do it under Dr. Parikh's umbrella. So again, back to you, Amish, but I learned so much from planning this with you. And like I said, hard taskmasters, but it was a thorough learning experience. It was an honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Sevanthi, and thank you, everyone. With this, we conclude our PCP series for 2020. Thank you very much.